This is Scott Richmond.
And Arnie Sherman.
You're listening to What Do You Know on News Talk KGVO, AM 1290 and 98.3 FM. Arnie, good morning to you.
What's good about it?
Well, we're healthy right now.
We're healthy right now, but we have no one's been tested, basically. You know, as our listeners know, because this is going to air on the weekend, we're in the early part of what's going to be, I think, a brutal couple of month lockdown in the United States to try to flatten out and minimize the effect of COVID-19.
Yeah, Tom Friedman was just on CNN, and he was saying, if everybody would stay home for 2 to 3 weeks, we would have profound impact on COVID-19.
And there's regional differences, as I can see already, in people's willingness to do that. I mean, up until earlier in this week, the beaches all in Florida were open, and spring breakers were down there packing them. I saw pictures. So the restaurants were open. The beaches were open.
Right.
You know, and then those kids are going to go back home all over the country. And, you know, it has a dramatic effect.
Yeah.
The less people who get exposed, you know, the less deaths you're going to have, and the less economic impact. For those of our listeners who think, well, I live out in Frenchtown or I live
Hamilton,
you know, I'm not going to get it. It's not around here. That's not the point. The point's going to be if there's 20% unemployment and lots of businesses are shut down and the ripple effect goes into all kinds of businesses. Like, you know, this past week they closed the General Motors plants.
Right.
And, you know, there are
a slowdown in automotive.
And a slowdown in everything. Less banking. The bankers closing the lobbies. You know, people at home that are living, you know, 58% of Americans live paycheck to paycheck. That's what happens if you don't get one for 2 months? You know, a lot of people in the Missoula area are in the service industry. They're waiters and waitresses. Their kids are coming home early from college. You know, normally they would take some of those jobs in the summertime. They're already home. They're not working.
Totally.
You know, so it has a very significant medical impact, you know, impact on life, but also has an economic impact. And on today's show, that's what we're going to talk about.
Who's our guest, Arnie?
Well, it's Dr. Robert, as I call him, Tino, and that's his nickname, Robert Sonora, who is the Associate Director for Health Research at the Bureau of Business and Economic Research at the University of Montana. And he just completed a study on the impact of COVID-19 on the economy and the economy in Montana. So he has some data and some information that we haven't seen before.
So we'll ask him a lot of good questions. Wow, couldn't have a better guest.
Couldn't have a better guest and a more timely guest. And there's, you know, lots of people who are, you know, nervous and, you know, rightfully so about what the future might hold in the short term. If the U.S. goes into a 20% unemployment, de Blasio in New York said it could be worse than the Great Depression. Could be. You know, and that would send shivers down people's spines. Those of us that remember what the impact might have been of the Great Depression, a lot of millennials and others don't, but, you know, I mean, breadlines.
How does something like this happen where it gets to this point, right?
Because we're a very global world. People fly and travel all over the place. I mean, little old Missoula, Montana's got thousands of international travelers every month. Some people just came back. I was reading on social media. A couple just came back from Europe today or yesterday.
Right.
From being in Europe.
But how does it get to this point where it becomes a pandemic? Meaning, aren't there enough safety measures in place to where something like this would trigger? Wait a minute.
Well,
we're seeing an outbreak here.
They haven't tested enough people. And from what I understand, and it's changing all the time, by the time this air, there may be a different interpretation, but it looks like this thing is the most contagious before there are symptoms, when you're asymptomatic.
Wow, so you don't even know.
So you got talking. Anything.
Amazing.
You know, 2 weeks ago, you were in Europe, you were in a restaurant somewhere, you picked it up in the restaurant, you come home, you feel fine, you're home for a week, you've been going to work. You've been running around, and all of a sudden you start getting symptoms. By that time, how many people could you have infected?
I wonder if there's levels of severity of it, meaning people could have a mild case of it.
Well, I think there is. And you know, we're not going to talk about the medical, but there, certainly, I mean, if only, you know, if 1 to 3% of the people that get it die, and most of those either are elderly or have underlying conditions of some sort, then for most people, they're not going to die from it. But the more people that get mild cases or say, well, I'm 30 years old and in great health,
right,
I'm not going to get this, the more that those people are not going to sequester in place. They're not going to stay at home, and they're going to go out and infect other people, and they're going to eventually get to more people that are vulnerable.
Yeah.
I mean, if you're in New York City and you're 25 and you said, I work out every day and I have a great immunity.
Right, yeah, go to the gym.
So I get on the subway. You know, I go to the library. You know, these things are closing now for very good reason. But for a week, I could have been running around infecting hundreds of people who then go and infect other people. So that's the reason why everybody had, this is all in. This is all or nothing in a way.
I think we're going to be forever changed after this. I hope we are. Meaning, I hope when we get out through the other side,
yeah,
that there's some level of, you know, the fail safes that should have been triggered, trigger quickly, and we're more careful and we're more, we're more aware of things that are going on. And we're like, hey, we got to shut this down, you know?
Yep.
We have to, first of all, I don't know why our president kind of kept that.
Well, there's political reasons, obviously. But I think our guest is here.
Okay, good.
And
let's
bring him in and talk about the economic side of all of this.
All right, back after this. All right, we are back with our guest.
Our guest is Dr. Robert Sonora, or as we call him, Tino, from the Bureau of Business and Economic Research at the University of Montana, who has just finished doing research in a study on the coronavirus economic impact. Was it just the economic impact in Montana, or was it just in general?
No, I mean, right now we have to just kind of concentrate on the whole globe, the United States, because we don't really have that much information for Montana, as you know. I mean, this is...
Right.
We've tested hardly anybody.
We've tested 12 people. I looked at the most recent data. There are now 12 cases in Montana, so... Yeah, we're just starting.
12 identified cases.
12 identified cases as of today.
Wow.
Which is for everybody listening, it's the 18th of March.
We're taping on the 18th of March. We're going to run this a few times.
Yeah, yes. And I think that's an important day because by the time you guys put this on the air, this is all might be old news. So the way things are going, it's happening so fast.
Is there any consistency with respect to the folks that have been diagnosed, age, gender?
Is it
across the board?
Yeah, I think some of the biggest issues have been that some of the early testing was done on a particular demographic group.
Ah.
And so we kind of got skewed data. I'm not entirely sure how accurate this statistic is, but something like 60% of Chinese men smoke. So it seemed like, oh, if you're over 50 and you smoke, then you must get it. But it turns out that that sample was really biased because so many people smoke there. There's also been a lot of movement towards not testing younger people. The Italians did not test people in their 20s and 30s because they were asymptomatic. But the Koreans went in and tested everybody. And the Koreans, and they found that, you know, just about the same percentage of people that were in the younger demographic groups were also.
I saw that in the Montana early numbers in the first 12, there were a number of people in their 20s and 30s.
Right. Yeah. So it knows that it's indiscriminate regarding age.
Well, because we haven't tested enough. Out of the 10 or 12 countries that have been testing, we've tested the least.
Pretty close to that. Yeah. I just read a morbidly funny, I guess, if you will, statistic about our testing and that people in the United States are waiting 3 or 4 days. In Senegal, you can get your test within 4 hours. Yeah, we're a little bit behind the eight ball on the testing. I think to date, we've tested roughly 50,000 people. Across the country.
Out of 339 million.
Right.
When did you, Tina, start studying this? Like, as I know, this is obviously COVID-19 is relatively new, right? It's 3 months?
3 months. Well, the first case was in November.
So November.
So first case that they found in China was in November. And then, of course, they exploded. Well, I mean, I think what really started getting me interested was, you know, we started thinking about SARS epidemics and swine flu or H1N1 flu. Mm. Others kind of recent. Then kind of hovering in the background has always been the Spanish flu epidemic and post-World War I period when roughly, 40 to 50 million people died of that.
But that was when the country was about 150 million.
And that's globally too, right? Yeah.
Right.
But I think what really sort of started catching was the rapid increase in China. And I started thinking about it in economics terms as when the rates started going up really, really quickly in China, and when they started clamping down and shutting down basically the whole province in China, and then watching it sort of migrate from China to Korea to Japan to the United States, et cetera, Europe. And then, of course, what really got me sort of going is when all of the bond yields started going berserk and stock markets started collapsing, and the, you know, the fear of the VIX index started rising really rapidly. I've been watching, I always keep an eye on bond yields. It's kind of like the thermometer of an economy, and basically in real time, plays a lot into expectations of what's going to happen. And so by looking at those bond yields, you kind of get a sense of what the future will bring and how markets view the future. And the markets, you know, they people make and lose a lot of money in the market, so they don't want to mess around. It's not a political statement. It's just, it is what it is. And so when that started really going berserk, that's where
it's really been following. The ups and downs have been dramatic. We've had 8 or 10 of the largest drops in the history of the market in the last month.
But did you say, so in November of 19 is when you kind of decided to move forward, and then you started looking at the bond yield simultaneously, or that prior
I started really concentrating in January, actually, when it really 19. Started of 20.
Oh, 20. Okay.
Yeah. When it really, I mean, I always kind of keep an eye on bond yields because I'm, because that's what I do. But I think, I really started, like I said, when Wuhan started really clamping down on movement of people, that's when I really started paying a lot more attention to it.
I see.
And then you could sort of watch, you know, you can sort of watch news unfold as the bond yields are kind of falling.
Yeah,
and
what are they
up.
Telling you now?
Well, they're telling me the 10-year bond slipped below 1% last week. It went to about 0.7, I think. It finished on Thursday or Wednesday of last week. And that, to me, is a sign of fear. People are moving towards safety. So you basically see stock markets and bond yields move in opposite directions. So people are fleeing right. out of the stock markets, moving drastically into bond yield, into bonds, buying bonds. It's still the safest place to go. You know, the stock market, I was looking at the stock market today before I came, because everything's happening so fast. I'm literally having to do something like every hour just to keep an eye of things. But I think S&P 500 and the Dow Jones Industrials, 30 of the stocks, that index, are roughly where they were in January of 2017 right now. So there's been 0% growth now.
Oh my gosh.
I mean,
0% growth. And it looks like there may be a minus 5% growth next quarter.
That's just in the stock markets, correct?
Right.
Yeah. I mean, I think we'll see some stabilization. I think as we get more knowledge and more information, there's so much uncertainty out there still, that's why we're seeing so much volatility in the markets. But once we get a little bit more certainty, we get a little bit better handle of how this virus kind of reacts, who's getting sick in a better way, I think markets will start to calm down a little bit. And then people, of course, will start taking advantage of very low prices. And
right. Lots of stuff has dropped dramatically.
Right.
But it's still liquid, a third though. Of what they were a year ago. Or not a year ago, a month ago.
I think the market started tanking in February 20th.
Yeah.
So it's lost. And that was what it peaked out in the 20th. That was the highest stock markets it had been. And now it's back where we were.
It was almost to 30, and now it's down to 19.
It's it's crazy.
So there's been a lot of change. And stocks like, you know, some of these, not barometer stocks, but stocks that have been running up, like Tesla, which was almost 1,000, is down to 300.
Yeah. I mean, and that's why I kind of like prefer to look at like a broader base stock index. I don't even like to look at the Dow Jones, because that's only 30 companies. Right?
Right.
I prefer to look at the S&P 500 or even NASDAQ, which is a couple thousand. Although the way they weight their index is a little funny.
But I was going to say the reaction, you know, the panic reaction when you see a company like Boeing, for example, who doesn't run airlines. They just produce planes. And
right.
So they're down the supply chain somewhere to under $100 a share. You know, for the first time in recent memory.
Well, and
that's surprising.
Well, and what's really surprising is if you put it in the context of the whole MAX plane issue,
right?
Because you know, you would have thought that would have really driven down the stock price quite a bit. Because again, you know, the MAX is theoretically stock prices represent long term future expected profits of a firm, and so you would suspect that the MAX would really have these sort of far-reaching, down-the-road kind of effects where, you know, we're sitting on 550 or 100 planes that we can't sell. So, yeah, that's going to have profit issues down the road. Yeah. Whereas this is most likely to be a relatively short-term type of shock. I mean, we'll know a lot more in a month. You know, it's like literally month or week, even by week. But this is going to be a relatively short-term impact. It's the airlines that are taking the hit. As you said, the Boeing's upstream from the airlines. Right. And so it's the airlines are going to be on the front, on the you know, sort of right in the trenches right now. Airlines are one step removed. You know, yeah, they'll see their orders go down perhaps, but...
Yeah, but the airlines are getting really hammered.
Well, Steve Mnuchin said, he goes, this looks worse than post 9/11 for the airlines.
Right.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I mean, that was a kind of an event that was a quote-unquote one-off event.
Right.
You know, and this is a rolling event. This is a global event. You know, 9/11 was an event that happened in the United States, primarily in New York City.
In an hour.
In an hour. This is something that's like...
In D.C.
In D.C. Yeah, yeah. And Pennsylvania.
Right.
Yeah.
But you're right. This is rolling, and that was a boom, a traumatic event.
Right. Well, no one knows how long this is going to roll.
No one knows how long this is going to roll, and if we can't get this thing under control, it could roll for a while.
And there's no reason to think, and I'm not a pessimist, you know, and I'm not a conspiracy theory person, and I'm not somebody who thinks about the worst case basis. But there's nothing that says you can't have another COVID-20 that emerges at the same time this is going on.
Right, or we get complacent, right?
Right.
That's another fear is there's an echo effect of this, and that could have, you know, firm eradications. Yeah. I mean, you know, hopefully if that happens, this particular virus will not have mutated, you know, will become immune to it. If you get it, you'll get immune, and then
fine.
But,
vaccine.
But if there's a you know, generation, a 2.0 version, then
you could see other people getting. So, so for our listeners who say, well, I'm not in the stock market, I don't really care, I don't even know what the S&P is, what's the effect of, as some people might have speculated, of a 20% unemployment rate?
20% seems extreme to me, but let's just think about it just in your daily life. I mean, how many of your... What do you do when you walk out the door and you go shopping, or you go to the restaurant, or you go to your wherever you go, you go to the gym, you know, now suddenly you can't. You're sort of hunkered down in your basement or wherever, surrounded by your, you know, bags of beans. What are you going to do? Well, those businesses now suddenly have lost all demand. I mean, this is going to be this is going to be the big issue is, you know, I'm sitting at home, I'm having potatoes or whatever. So I'm not going to local restaurants. And so the local restaurants aren't getting my revenue. They're still having to pay their fixed costs, right? They got mortgage, electricity, stuff like this to pay. They may be very generous towards their employees and keep them on the books, you know, maybe at reduced hours or something, even though they're not working.
For a month, but if this goes on for 3 or 4 months, they're not going to do it.
It gets very problematic, exactly. And so it just has a ripple effect through the whole entire economy. And that's why I think people might suspect that it's going up. It could go that high. You know, the unemployment rate is kind of a tricky statistic insofar as it really only counts people that are quote unquote in the labor market. That means they're either working or looking for work. The unemployment rate came down in part after the financial crisis because people just simply quit looking. So the unemployment rate, you know, we have sort of quote unquote, I prefer what is known as the employment population ratio as a statistic for these kinds of events, because what that measures is the actual number of employed to the total population. And that statistic, over the period of time from about 2010, when employment backs out at 10%, that ratio was about 53%, the employment population ratio. And then over time, you could gradually watch the unemployment rate drop down, you know, to, you know, 9, 8, et cetera, percent. At that same time, the employment population ratio stayed fixed at 53% for about 6 years. So what that tells me is that there was a lot of people that just said, I'm not interested in even looking for work. And so the unemployment rate kind of overestimates, if you will, the level of employment.
Right.
And so...
So you already have a base of people that don't have a lot of income as a result of that.
Yes.
And now you're going to layer on
retired,
top of that.
Or retired.
Right, you know, they're just not in the labor market. They're not earning, you know, a cost of living wage.
Right.
And you're going to layer on top of that, you know, General Motors shut down this week in Detroit.
Right.
Restaurants, you mentioned, movie theaters, retail.
Travel. Hotels.
Companies that have to.
Car rental.
You know, global companies that sell services can't send their employees out to sell services.
So service and retail. And then the supply chain that supplies them slows down.
Slows down. And then you get that sort of backward ripple effect. Right. It's like, you know, you know, we always use the sort of analogy, you throw a stone and you watch that thing just kind of dissipate, and it eventually goes away, but how big of a stone you throw in represents the shock.
Right.
Economists use the word shock. So this is basically what we call a economic, macroeconomic shock. The size of that shock has bigger waves. You know, if one country receives a shock, it has a relatively small ripple effect across the economy and the world economy. But this is like somebody threw a boulder into your right. fish pond out behind your house kind of thing.
I'm going to call you Robert or Tino. So let's look at the different generations. So the boomers, right? So what happens with the boomers now, right? Like they're going to recede, they're going to pull back. Like they're the ones that are spending the discretionary income. They have the discretionary income because they've been saving it for years. They slow down.
Because they just lost a piece of it.
Right. They saw 30% of their savings, that's a minimum,
yeah.
go away. What happens?
Well, nothing good, as you might imagine. Some people who might be considering retiring, for example. Now suddenly that's out the window.
I've heard two people tell me that today.
Right.
They were going to retire this year. Now they're not.
Now they can't.
They can't.
They can't.
They can't afford to.
They can't afford to because it's just their portfolio.
Or
just
this actually, you know, spurs it on. This is a catalyst for retirement. It's like, I'm getting out. Like I don't want to work.
I'm eligible for Social Security. I can figure out how to live on that.
That's right.
I move to Mexico as soon as they let me in.
Yeah, right. Once they open the borders again.
I'm moving to Mexico.
Yeah, okay, that generation.
And to be honest, I mean, a lot of the, you know, if you look at savings rates and you look at these kinds of things, a lot of it's driven by demographics. We have a relatively large cohort of people called, you know, the boomers, and they saved a lot. And that helped keep interest rates low because they were saving so much. So that pushes interest rates down. And you sort of look at the sort of time series of savings and savings rates, they've been dropping because there's so much supply, if you will, of savings. So savings markets are just like any other supply and demand from your Econ 101 class, right? More savings, lower price of money, lower interest rates, et cetera, et cetera.
But one of the misnomers I just want to throw out there about boomers, since I am one, is that the average boomer only has about $50,000 in savings.
Which is remarkable. And that's right. Right. You know, and that's it.
And they're counting on Social Security and their pensions to live off of. Correct. But they don't have a big cash reserve.
They don't have a big cash, but a lot of them have their own homes. We have a very high, most people have the vast majority of their savings is actually in their homes. And something like, ballpark 75% of Americans own their own home. So a lot of their wealth is in their
home. Right, and you don't know what effect this is going to have on the real estate market, for example.
Well, but what this might have then is if people suddenly have to stay in their homes, then what is this going to do to the housing markets? I mean, this could go off in a million different directions.
Oh, yeah.
So every time anybody says something, it's like—
The permutations are unbelievable.
Are unbelievable. So what happens to housing markets? Well, I wanted to move to Montana, for example, and I live in San Diego, and I've always wanted to ski all year round. So, but now I can't because, you know, my nest egg just went away. So my nest egg is gone. The only way I can move there is to sell my house, but my house value might go down and I can't.
Yeah, because everybody's nest egg's gone down and they're not going to pay what they were paying when they had a full nest egg.
Exactly.
And then you add on top of that, you know, the fact that 58% of Americans live from paycheck to paycheck.
Yeah, it depends on what I've read as high as 75%.
Wow.
So and you're right. Yes. I mean, the average 50 plus year old has, as you said, you know, maybe $50,000 in savings. That part of it is relying on the Social Security, right? It's like, well, I've been paying into Social Security my whole life. So that gives you people a disincentive from doing their own savings, right?
Right.
Or they don't have a job that offers them some sort of pension fund, a 401k or whatever.
Question. Our guest, by the way, is Robert Sonora from the University of Montana.
Bureau of Business and Economic Research.
Okay, perfect. Exactly. So Robert, who has the best models, right, from an economic standpoint at universities? Who has the best models that are predictive of, like, hey, to your point, they can go in a million different directions, but in academia, look to, whether it's yourself or others, for their models to say, hey,
this is a tricky question. So when the financial crisis happened, a lot of people were pretty quote unquote cocky about their models, right? So they really sort of had a pretty good sense of this. They had a pretty good sense of how risk, how financial markets, how money affects the economy. And then the financial crisis hit.
Mm-hmm.
And then suddenly a lot of those models kind of went out the window. And so another class of models kind of came in that tried to, I'm going to use some fancy economics terms, to endogenize money, meaning that, and many of these older previous versions, pre-crisis versions of the models, money was quote-unquote exogenous. It was just something that was out there. The Fed or a central bank would come in and inject cash in and to pull cash out. Mm-hmm. And so it was sort of like an unpredictable element of the economy, if you will. So this next class of models said, well, this is not correct. You know, if I've got to pay off my lenders, and now you want me to put more money into the economy, you want me to lend more money, but I've got to pay off previous lenders. Now suddenly that money that was supposed to get injected into the economy shrinks. So if you look at, there's something called the money multiplier. And if you look at the money multiplier in a financial crisis, what you see is, then what the money multiplier basically says is that for every dollar that the central bank injects into the economy, it generates $1 plus
X,
right. X amount. And it was right. About 50 cents. So the money multiplier is about 1.5. During the financial crisis, the central bank here was injecting so much money that actually became a money divider.
They don't have any money left, do they?
There's tons of money. There's lots of money floating around. It's just that the banks were not taking that money and then lending it and injecting it back into the economy. So what the Fed is doing now is exactly the same thing.
Right.
So I'm trying to skirt around this question about what models do I use. I don't know if there's any model that really kind of tries to concurrently have a business cycle, if you will.
Right.
So a lot of times what happens, I mean, the Mexicans have a great phrase. It's right. Or not the Mexicans, just in general, is when the United States coughs, the world catches a cold, right? States is such a big sort of behemoth economy that anything that happens in the United States kind of impacts the rest of the world. And the same kind of effect happens is that when we think about what we call the international transmission of business cycles, it tends to be sort of like a sequential event. And you can watch a lot of these crises, particularly in developing countries, that they sort of get exported from one country to the next, and then they kind of travel. But there's a time there. This is something that's happening, boom, at the same time.
Right.
I mean, it's affecting the global economy simultaneously.
Catastrophic.
Yeah. Right. And so I don't think any of our models are actually prepared for something like
yes.
What is
so? Let me ask you this,
please.
Yeah,
I'm going to make a statement, then ask you a question.
Okay.
We did a huge tax cut for corporations in America, not so much for middle class or lower class, and they got huge tax breaks. Unlike individual citizens who are constantly told to save money for a rainy day, and you know you need to have more than $50,000. Most of the big companies that got the tax break, instead of saving the money, went out and bought their stock back from the public marketplace.
Right.
So now they're turning around and saying, I want to be bailed out. At a time when interest rates are almost zero, why should they be bailed out? Why don't they go and borrow money like anybody else, use their assets as collateral? They can get loans for almost nothing. Why should we bail out anybody?
Well, part of it is purely from that demand standpoint. All right. Now, yeah, you might be morally opposed to this, and I think a lot of people are morally opposed to this because it creates what is known as moral hazard, right?
Yeah.
And this is the same thing with the banks. I mean, you guys, again, I mean, I just use the financial crisis, you know, the whole TARP program, the Troubled Assets Relief Program, whereby banks had made a lot of risky loans, had taken on a bunch of risky debt, a lot of dodgy assets, if you will. And then, you know, then the Fed came in and said, you will take this money from us because we have to give it to you because we need to create liquidity. And that, of course, just creates incentive for these guys to do the same thing. And then to your point, in terms of the recent corporate tax breaks that were given, a lot of that was intended to spur new investment.
Which in new, didn't necessarily
do. Well, and yeah, according to Goldman Sachs or I think it was Goldman Sachs, they basically found that about, for every dollar, they were going to invest about 15 cents in new capital.
Right.
So, and then they were going to give their wage, you know, a one-time shock to workers, maybe, a annual payoff of $1,000.
But Boeing bought back 90 million shares.
Well, this is the thing, right. Right. Exactly. And so what did we do? I mean, and actually, I just saw a thing with Mark Cuban today.
Yeah.
I was just, you know, again, this is happening so fast. And he says that absolutely there should be something said that if you take tax money, prepare money bailing out, you will not be able to buy your own stock back, period.
Yeah.
Well,
that should be.
And that's exactly right, because it's just a moral hazard, and you get a breakdown of what we call the marginal social cost and the marginal private benefit.
Well, the bailout, the tax break was to stimulate the economy.
Right.
And buying your own stock back doesn't stimulate the economy.
No. If you want to take money and then go invest in new roads or or education or reskilling workers is, you know, what's going to happen? Is this shock going to be a similar type of shock of the financial crisis where basically everything changed, like how we produce things started to change because there, you know, firms learned how to be more productive with the workers they had. So they invested more capital. Then the workers were like, oh, well, everything's fine now. Hire us back. We're like, well, we don't need you anymore. So are they going to invest in education?
Yeah, there should be some more restrictions. But if you look to the second half of the question, I mean, this is something in essence that that they would accuse Bernie Sanders of. We're going to give corporations, we're going to...
Right.
I mean, the airlines are asking for $50 billion, right? They got a tax break. They went and bought their stock. They're asking for $50 billion, basically a grant. They're not even necessarily saying they're going to pay it back. And if they pay it back, probably not with interest. Why doesn't the administration just say, hey, you're pretty, you got a lot of, you know, you got a lot of assets, go borrow it. The interest rates are zero.
Yeah, I mean, and I don't know if the airlines asked for it specifically, this is happening so fast, or if it's just included in the package.
No, they've asked for it. They've said they need at least $50 billion.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, this is a similar sort of thing that happened again. I'm just going to keep using the financial crisis because it was a similar and relatively recent, so it should be fresh in everybody's mind. You know, obviously we gave a lot of money to Ford and Chevrolet, but that was a loan, and that was a fairly high interest rate loan. The bankers were basically told, you will take our money, and whether they wanted it or not, they had to take it.
Right, and then they got paid back.
And they got paid with interest. So, yeah, I agree. I don't see how, you know, how we, the taxpayer, should always be picking up for the corporations.
How can we keep
except for
printing money,
right?
Because a trillion here and a trillion there, pretty soon you're talking about a lot of money.
Well, fortunately, we don't have to worry about money. We can always print a quote-unquote print more money.
Yeah.
The point being is that basically what the Fed will do is just print money and buy debt from the and then keep the money flowing. And we can, you know, we're borrowing at 0% interest, the government. So, right. I mean, this is like, if you're going to do this, I would take a bigger issue, maybe not so much with this particular package that's been released with $50 billion. I have a little bit bigger issue with the tax break in general. Usually you offer a tax break and fiscal stimulus in periods when you're in a time of recession,
right?
And not in a period of an expansion. All that what is it, the U.S. Jobs Act or what, I can't remember the exact name of it, that was in 2018 or 17, all it did was expand the deficit.
At a time when there was growth going on.
When there was growth going on, we should be paying off the deficit. We, you know, the deficit was closing, and now suddenly we're back to a $1 trillion a year deficit.
A year.
We could be at, like, you know, turning again. I'm looking at CBO. No one's really done any projections since the recent kind of chaos has happened. This can't do this overnight, but the CBO is projecting, you know, probably this is going to add another $1 trillion. That's right. I'm sorry, the Congressional Budget Office. You know, once this comes out, they'll probably try to analyze it. They will show that the deficit next year, this year, could be as high as $2 trillion. And that will, of course, add to the debt. At the same time, you got to remember, that's just the fiscal stimulus from the spending from the federal government. At the same time, people aren't working, so tax revenues are going to be falling.
Right.
And these kinds of things. So you're going to see an expansion of the deficit from this of over $1 trillion, I suspect, by the end.
And what about all the calls for a balanced budget and fiscal responsibility?
Those evaporated when they signed the Jobs Act. I mean, there's a lot of discussion that we can't keep spending money like this, and then suddenly it's okay to spend money.
Yeah.
So this becomes a political discussion, and so we'll just leave it at that.
Well, here's an interesting fact. While we're talking here, it'll be a little bit old news when we air, right? But the first U.S. congressman, Republican Mario Diaz-Balart of Florida, 58-year-old Republican, has been diagnosed with COVID-19.
Yeah.
So we'll see how, if this starts moving through Congress,
why wouldn't it?
Yeah, yeah.
Why wouldn't it?
It will. And we've got the Brazilian, you know, trade minister, or I can't remember, health minister who accompanied.
But this is the first member of the 535, you know, the U.S. Congress that have gotten it.
Yeah.
And he's not in the targeted age range either. He's 58.
Right. Well, he is a targeted. I mean, the question is, you know, a lot of people, you know, can, it's like, not to downplay it, but it's, you know, the coronavirus is obviously a multi-talented virus. And it's one of the lungs and everything. So, you know, the mortality rates right now are, you know, in the 1-2% range if you get it. A lot of people who are younger are asymptomatic, period. I mean, right. they're carrying
and
it, but they don't know.
And that's part of the reason, as you indicated, they want to flatten the curve. Because if it's 1-2%, if only 20 million people get it, then you're talking about, you know, 200,000 to 300,000 dead.
Right.
If 100 million people get it, you're talking about, much
statistics.
2 million up. To 3 million
let's,
dead.
Let's do a quick ID. Our guest is Dr. Robert Sonora from the University.
It was the Bureau of Business and Economic Research at the University of Montana.
Somebody was saying that, like, this could be our World War II moment, right? Where, you know, look, we don't have enough bed space. We don't have enough respirators. Right. We don't have enough of this. We don't have enough of that in this country. So, you know, during World War II, what? They shut Chrysler, Ford, Chevy. They all shut down making cars. And what, they start producing tanks and Jeeps and all these kinds of things. I mean, we could, you know, have, if a portion of this passage was actually like a sort of World War II-esque type of stimulus. It doesn't need to be that big because we're not fighting a war. But, well, we are of sorts. But if it was a stimulus, it was like, look, we need to build more respirators. Let's just have all you people that are not, you know, delivering Domino's pizzas, now you're going to be making respirators and these kinds of things. I mean, obviously it's exaggeration, but that's the idea. And it's like,
well, you certainly could do it. There's empty campuses. There's lots of places to put people to work. If you can get more, if you're allowed to put more than two people in a room together.
Right. But the problem is, you know, there's always, you know, Truman's famous statement, on one hand, I want a one-hander economist, because he always says on the one hand, on the other. You know, I read that one guy came up with a coronavirus like vaccine or, you know, in the 1990s or something, and he's trying to shop it around again. And the pharmaceutical companies are saying, well, why would we invest in this if it might not be around in a year? So we invest all this money in some sort of vaccine or something.
Remember Zika?
Yeah, right.
That was the same thing.
Yeah, Zika, exactly the same thing. So again, that's where the federal government steps in and says, look, we will take care of your R&D expenditures on this. This is the type of call to arms that really needs to happen. Yeah.
Do you feel like, was there anyone, either in fiction or in writing or an economist, that predicted this, that like there was like, you know, like we used to talk about Nostradamus, like was someone predicting this type of pandemic that just spread so quickly and caught people off by such surprise?
I don't think there's anybody that's predicted it per se, but certainly historically we have examples of things like this, and that's why I want to bring up the Spanish flu virus.
Yeah, 1918.
The flu influenza the late teens. It was a global pandemic and had a huge repercussions for the global economy. Similar, this is, you know, I think some other things in recent memory haven't had as sort of dramatic as effect as potentially this one could, and I'm not saying it will have a dramatic effect. We won't know. But certainly SARS was one of those types of events that people consider could be sort of a global pandemic type of thing that would really have serious ramifications for the economy. Likewise with H1N1, where you had quite a number of people got very, very ill, and we had quite a number of people died
from
that.
Well, you know what's interesting? You know, we weren't around. None of us was around when that happened. It was an H1N1 influenza, the Spanish flu of 1918. And it affected 27% of the world's population at the time.
That was huge.
And which was about 2 billion. And between 17 and 50 million people died.
Yeah, it was enormous. It was a huge, huge deal. And so it's like, how do you predict this? I mean, obviously, I think a lot of virologists and immunologists and doctors, they've all said, you know, there is a global pandemic coming and we have to prepare for it. And I think in this country, we kind of de-prepared for it over the past few years. And now we're sort of stuck with the ramifications.
I mean, I don't even remember. I'm not that much. And I apologize to our listeners that I'm not as much of a history buff. But that came at right after World War II. So the world was recovering.
The Spanish influenza?
Yeah.
World War One.
I mean, excuse me, World War One. World War One went from 1913 to 1917. And the world's just recovering from the millions that got slaughtered in World War One and the economic devastation of World War One, and this pandemic comes along and just wipes out, you know, 50 million people.
Well, and I think that's why that's maybe not a fair comparison. I mean, because obviously infrastructure was weakened following World War One, you know, medical things were all broken after World War One, and they weren't as good as they are today.
No.
So certainly something
The only silver lining is we recovered from all that.
We recovered, but the scale will be a lot smaller, I suspect.
Yeah,
and I think
I would suspect
that's why
too.
We just need to have more information. And so we're all kind of, you know, reaching around the dark. You know, we got this canary in the coal mine that's kind of quit chirping, but we're not really sure what got the canary. Is it lack of oxygen? Is it maybe a cat ate it? I don't, you know, no one really knows at this point. And so that's kind
and
of
the problem is the problem is that this sort of thing is not just left to the discretion or the decision making of the medical community. There's a political overlay to all of this, where, and I won't necessarily pick at the U.S., but you know, number of countries want to downplay it. They want to live in a world of wishful thinking. It's not going to be so bad. Slow to react. I mean, in the UK, the shows are still running. Most of the shows are still running in the UK, and they haven't decided to do what we've done here. And you're going to, you know, obviously going to see a spike, you know, over there because they're taking a slightly different approach.
Well, I think the thing is, you know, what I think is kind of remarkable is you look at two countries, Korea and Italy, and their response, and both of their responses have been fairly, you know, aggressive. I was going to say draconian, but aggressive is probably a better word. And just the experiences of those two countries is remarkable. I mean, you know, Korea, they accelerated. They came out of the gate really fast, but they got that curve and it's flattened out.
Yep, they flattened out. They're having more people that are recovering than are getting sick at this point in time.
I mean, it's flattening out a lot. The United States, as of the most recent data.
Why do we have a problem not learning how to stay inside in the United States?
You know,
we're consumers.
Let's be honest. Here in Montana, we're relatively lucky because, you know, we got space. I mean, I can't imagine what this must be like if I was in like Manhattan
or New Jersey
or retirement home in Florida
or in Washington, right? Or something like that.
Boca del Vista, right? You know, in Florida.
My mother is.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, exactly.
Yeah. And that's where the biggest issues are going to be. I mean, we're pretty isolated here, which is good, you know, from that perspective. So that's a good thing. Why are we so slow? There's a lot of questions that we have. I think there's going to be a lot of questions asked. You know, why does it take so long for us to have a test? And when the CDC came out with a test, it was a faulty test. Meanwhile, there's a perfectly good test put out by the World Health Organization,
right.
WHO. So why didn't we use their test? Or the Germans came out with a test within the third week of January. Why didn't we use their test?
Why are we so slow?
There's political decisions.
Well, this becomes a political decision, obviously, out of the purview of my expertise. But certainly, just my reading of the things is, you know, it's just an unwillingness to sort of face the music kind of thing.
Doesn't that factor into your study, though? Because you're looking at COVID-19, the economic impact, but that's a big kind of
That's why I like to look at the financial
influence.
Markets, because the financial markets really are truly. This comes back, circle. The financial markets do not mess around. I'd use a stronger word,
right.
but they're not messing around. They take information. Now that information might end up being wrong, but at the time, given the best information they have at that time, this is how they react. And so when you look at a speech given and markets tanking like the second the speech is given, that's not good, right? That has implications not only for the perceptions of the policy makers as a whole, but also maybe their ability to conduct policy in the future. It's going to have implications for economic expectations are in the future. I mean, right now we have a range of second quarter GDP growth forecasts between, I think the best is something like -3% contraction. And the worst is like a 12% retraction in second quarter. That's like now. So, or next quarter will be a contraction of upwards of 11%. Now that might be a little high, probably a little bit high, but we're looking at a pretty severe contraction in the second quarter of this year. And this quarter will be flat without a doubt. I think Italy is probably already in recession, even though they're not officially in recession. I suspect
it would have to be.
Spain, similar story. Germany, similar.
Yeah.
Let's do a quick break. We're going to let's do our final segment with Dr. Robert Sonora right after this. All right, we are back.
Tino, so beside the bureaus Facebook page. Where else can people go to get information about what's going on if they want it in real time?
Well, I you know, any of your reputable newspapers are great. I mean, the Wall Street Journal, it doesn't matter if you're a liberal or conservative. There's good information out on both sides, obviously. You know, I rely on the Wall Street Journal. I read The Economist a lot. I New York Times, The Washington Post. Whatever I can get my hands on. I look at a lot at Market Watch, a lot of financial press, particularly in this period. Because I sort of think of financial markets and the real economy. The real economy is, you know, production of goods and services. It's about employment. It's about these kinds. But the financial market is kind of the underbelly or the flip side of the same coin. So when we discuss financial markets and exchange rates and these kinds of things, we're kind of looking the same thing, but from a slightly different perspective. And again, the reason as I mentioned the financial markets is because it's instantaneous. You know, we might get, you know, unemployment insurance figures every 2 weeks or something like this. But again, we need something faster. We need almost day by day. Now, again, to be fair, some of the financial market data is going to be noise. And it's just, you know, that's just the way it is. It's just markets reacting to what's going on at the time. You know, and we won't be able to sort of figure out what that noise to signal to noise ratio is until we get enough data.
But markets are generally reliable. They remind me of grandparents. Really. Like when your grandma says to you, don't do that. Or, you know, if you do
put
that, this is going to happen.
Right,
usually right about things.
Right.
Is this one of the meatiest kind of studies that you've ever undertaken in your role?
Yes and no. I mean, yes, insofar as it's a lot like the financial crisis where we're really able to track this in real time. I mean, that's what's been so fascinating. I think there's these last two, from an economist perspective, you know, it's the dismal science. So of course, you know, economists get very sexy at these times of, these types of periods.
You're our guest.
Right. You know, exactly. So, but being able to follow things in real time and having, you know, at my fingertips, knowledge like instantaneously is just fascinating to watch, and trying to again, extract that signal from all the noise is really interesting. And it's a fast moving thing, but it's also kind of rolling at the same time where you can sort of see where things are going. And so
if you have the stock market, the Dow or the S&P, and on another screen, you have Trump or Pence or Dr. Fauci speaking and they say something.
Oh yeah.
You can watch. It's almost like a lie detector test.
It's unbelievable. That's why we kind of.
Yeah.
But there's other kinds of interesting data that you can get that's not quote unquote so official. So I learned today actually that the reservation app.
There's OpenTable.
OpenTable, right? So they've released their data, and you could sort of compare the year on year percent change in the amount of reservations by state and by some cities. So I was just, you know, Montana, unfortunately, they don't have data for Montana. I don't know if enough restaurants use OpenTable in Montana.
Well, we don't take many places take reservations.
Well, and there's that.
Not anymore.
And there's that. But in Washington, reservations are down 100% from last year.
100%?
So again, going back to those sectors that you were discussing that are really going to be heavily impacted, that's a temperature reading right there.
The service. I'm just thinking as we're talking, you're talking about how the market reacts to the real-time data that's coming from politics, et cetera. So can you ever think of a 21-day period in our lives that have been this dramatic, where the swings have been this dramatic? You've got Bloomberg falling out of the race. You've got people declaring Biden dead at the polls, right?
Right.
And Sanders is the presumptive winner of the
And
then literally a week later, everything turns around, and then this, in a week, turns around.
And the stock market goes from February 12th,
right,
when it's like...
Was that the day you said, February 12th or the 22nd?
Somewhere in there, the third week. We'll call it the third week of February.
So let's talk about 20 days, Arnie.
Yeah.
30 days.
Yeah, dramatic. It loses a third of the value.
Will this be known as like the, how they coin a term?
A lot of younger generation people, this is going to be a landmark time in their lives. They were let home from school a month and a half early. They don't have jobs because everything's shut down. They're supposed to stay home. You know, there's a million
quarantine.
It'll probably be
the word quarantine was never used.
They haven't lived through a number of these other things.
We were so hopeful. We were thinking about infrastructure investment and roads and, you know.
But this would be, but this is actually a good time to do that. I mean, you know, a lot of people, if you're, let's do some infrastructure investment. This is actually, this is part of that war, quote unquote, spending kind of idea that we don't just have to make ventilators. We don't need that many people to build ventilators, but we can certainly spend the money that people are now sitting at home and watching Netflix. Why not hire them to do road repairs, these kinds of things?
Well, I mean, you talk about silver lining. Amazon's hiring 100,000 people.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, and the delivery, they have to, right? The delivery service is going to go through the roof. So it's these kinds of industries that are going to be the most interesting. And then when we talked about restaurants and Open Table again, I mean, what's going to happen to Open Table now that there's no restaurants?
Yeah, well, they got nothing to do.
Even though they're not directly connected.
What's going to happen to dating apps? Where's Tinder?
You're going to have to actually call somebody.
You have to call somebody, but where are you going to take them? To your house?
Yeah, right.
Not
park.
Good. Park.
Fishing.
Golf. Everything we're suggesting doesn't sound good.
Golf.
Arnie,
hey, you're limited.
Tino, this has been a fascinating hour.
Thank you very much.
We're going to bring you back. It was always good talking with you, Tino.
Nice talking to you guys as well. I appreciate the opportunity to talk about this.
We appreciate you.
Very interesting stuff.
You're a great guest.
Thank you.
Thanks, guys.
See you next week.
Take care, Scott.
Thank you for listening to What Do You Know?
I can't wait for the next show, Scott.
I'm excited too, Arnie. If you'd like to suggest a guest, send me an email at scottrichman@townsquaremedia.com. We'll see you next week. And thanks for listening to News Talk KGVO.